نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي واجعل لي وزيرا من أهلي اللهم فقهنا في الدين رب زدني علما اللهم ألهمنا رشدا وعيذنا من شرور أنفسنا اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه اللهم أرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه آمين ثم آمين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. سورة البقرة chapter number 3 words 21. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اعْبُدُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. O mankind, worship your Lord, worship your Rabb, worship your Sustainer who created you and those before you, that you may become righteous. Verse 21 starts by the word Ya Ayyuha. It is a calling word. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling, addressing, in fact, inviting. Who is Allah inviting? In the verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not only inviting the Muslims, the believers, the people who offer salah, or who fast, or who perform Hajj. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is instead calling Ya Ayyuhan Nas, An-Nas, whole of the mankind. Remember, the message of Quran and the teachings of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were not just meant for a specific period or a specific region. Allah Himself says in Quran, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have not sent you but as a mercy for all the worlds. رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. The message of Quran was just not meant for the people of Makkah or Medina or the people of period of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but it is and will be for all the globe and for all the periods till Qiyamah. Islam is a global religion. Islam knows no boundaries. What lessons do we learn from this part of the verse, Ya Yuhannasu? The first, that we can get an idea of the vastness of our religion. Allah, the teachings of Quran, the message of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is so vast. What openness there is in the teachings of Quran. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all, save us all from being narrow-minded. Allah save us from narrow-mindedness and tightness of our hearts and souls. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with open-mindedness and save us from the rigidity of our thoughts. The second thing is the message of Quran and Hadith has to be spread to whom? Not only to the Muslims or the believers, but it has to be passed on to Ya Ayyuhan Nas, all the people of the globe. Just imagine what a colossal job has to be done. And to realize the extent of the job which has been done. Just let's analyze what a colossal job has to be done and how much of it has been done or has been achieved. You will all agree with me in the state of affairs of the Muslim Ummah that even in the literate class of the Muslim population, 5% of the population has not even read or gone through the translation of Quran. So just imagine the colossity of the job which remains to be done. And you know what? Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we know, we believe, we have faith, is what? He was the seal of prophets, Khatamun Nabiyyin. So there's going to be no prophet, no messenger of Allah who's going to come and who's going to complete this mission. So whose responsibility is this now? It is the responsibility of the people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has called in Quran as kuntum khayra ummatin. You are the best group of people. Who is it? It is us, the followers of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is our job. It is our duty and responsibility to spread the teachings of Quran and Hadith to all the mankind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, help us develop this sense of responsibility. And Allah, help us spend our time, our money, resources, our capabilities to spread the message of Quran and Hadith to mankind. And Allah, accept the small deeds and bless us with barakah in our time and our resources. And then, you know, another thing we need to gather from this verse is that what is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here inviting all his bondsmen for is? Allah is calling, Ya ayyuhan nasur ubudu rabbakum. Do what? Irbudu. Irbudu, which I explained when I was talking about Surah Al-Fatiha, that na'budu means that we will do what? It was a covenant with Allah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we will obey you. It was a covenant of obedience and we will worship you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here is inviting all the mankind to do what? To worship Allah and to be obedient to Allah. So you know what? This is actually what we need to invite people towards. This is the basic purpose why human beings were created, as Allah says in Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, that we did not create the jinns or human beings, but to be obedient or to worship Allah. So the primary call and the primary purpose of da'wah to all mankind has to be for what? To, when we are going to invite people towards Islam, is we're going to invite them towards the obedience of Allah. And obedience will be acquired by the worship of Allah, by the worship of the Creator. Verse number 22, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that worship and obey whom? الَّذِي جَعْلَ لَكُمُ الْأَرْضَ فِرَاشًا وَالسَّمَاءَ بِنَاءً وَأَنْزَلَ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً فَأَخْرَجَ بِهِ مِنَ الثَّمَرَاتِ رِزْقًا لَكُمْ فَلَا تَجْعَلُوا لِلَّهِ أَنْدَادًا وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. Worship and obey whom? He who made you. He made you. For you the earth a bed and the sky a ceiling, and sent down from the sky the rain, and brought forth thereby fruits as provisions for you. So do not attribute to Allah equals while you know that there is nothing similar to Him. So in this verse number 22, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has basically talked about His creations of in the earth, in the heavens, and has asked all of us to stay away from all forms of polytheism. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has asked us to stay steadfast on the belief of the oneness of Allah and on the concepts of monotheism. Verse number 23. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here says, وَإِنْ كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْبٍ مِمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِنْ مِثْلِهِ وَادْعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. And if you are in doubt about what we have sent down upon our servant Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then produce a surah like thereof, and call upon your witnesses other than Allah if you should be truthful. So now in this verse 23, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing all those who doubt the truth of Quran. That is all those who doubt in the prophethood of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the concept that revelations were sent to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the concept that revelations which were sent to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were the source of the verses of Quran. They are being addressed and they are being challenged to create, to write, or to present something similar to the verses of the Book of Allah. This was a challenge to the people of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's time, because in that time they used to say, "Na'uzu billah, summa na'uzu billah min zalik," that they did not accept and they did not have belief and faith in the prophethood of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or the revelations, and they used to say that these are not the word, that the verses of Quran which Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam presents as the teachings of Allah, they are actually, na'uzu billah min zalik, they are actually not the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has, na'uzu billah, created or fabricated them himself. And then they used to go on with the whole of their story, and they used to say that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam goes to the slaves of the people of the book, and there he listens to the verses of the people of the book, and then overnight, na'uzu billah, he makes a few alterations in these words and the formats, and then in the morning he presents them as the verses of Allah and the verses of Quran, and then he claims that he is getting revelations of Allah. And you know what? They used to also name the slaves of the people of the book. Like they used to say that he goes to Hibr, Yasar, Bal'an, Ya'ish. And the story used to go on. How very pointless and how senseless they were in making such allegations against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Firstly, because, you know, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was an ummi. He did not know how to read and write. So how was it possible for him to listen to the words or the verses in another language? Because we know that the teachings and the verses of the people of the book were in Ibrani. And then listening to the verses in another language, comprehending them and reproducing them as Arabic verses of Quran. And secondly, had there been any such slaves from whom Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was learning, then for sure these slaves would have had a very prestigious status among the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, being his teacher, being the teacher of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam themselves. They would have been regarded and they would have been given a lot of respect, but we find nothing of the sort. So to prove the falsehood of these people, who not only doubted, but also opposed and made false allegations of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenged them to make similar verses. That is, Allah said that if you claim that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has, na'uzu billah, fabricated the verses of Quran, then you think and you claim that this is possible, then okay, you go ahead yourself and do it yourself. And you call all your partners for help if you can do it. This was a challenge to all the people in the time of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it has been challenged for all the times. This challenge has been made 5 times in Quran, 4 times in the Makki surah, and 1 time in the Madani surah, that is Surah Al-Baqarah. Surah Baqarah, verse 23, here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes a challenge. And by the order of revelation, this was the last time this challenge was made, but by the order of arrangement, it is coming in the first order. Then Allah has challenged in the verse 38 of Surah Yunus, verse 39 of Surah Hud, verse 88 of Surah Bani Israel, and verse 33 and 34 of Surah At-Tur. But you know that this challenge has been there since the last 1400 years. There are places where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks the people to make a few verses or 10 verses or make a surah like the chapter, like the chapter of Quran, and similar forms of challenges have been present since 1400 years. Nobody had ever succeeded, and nobody will ever succeed in fabricating anything similar to the words of Allah, because Quran is a miracle. Quran is a miracle which was given to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you know what? Actually, the Arabs realized this miracle of Quran. Labid bin Rabia, he was a very renowned poet of the Arabs. And when he heard the verses of Surah An-Nasr, Inna aqwayna qal qawsar, fasalli li rabbika wanhar, inna shaniyaka huwal abtar. You know what he spontaneously said? The rhyming words, he said, Ma haza qalamul bashar. These are not the words of Quran. So Arabs, who knew everything about poetry and who knew about the Arabic language, they knew that these verses were not the verses of any human being. But despite all that, they just failed to believe and have faith and belief in them. Verse number 24. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues with his challenge and then says, فَإِن لَمْ تَفَلُوا وَلَنْ تَفَلُوا فَاتَّقُوا النَّارُ وَالَّذِي وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ أُعِدَّتْ لِلْكَافِرِينَ. But if you do not do what? If you are not successful and if you are not able to make a verse, a chapter, a surah like Quran, which you've been challenged to because of your failure of belief, if you do not, and you will never be able to, then fear the fire whose fuel is men and stones prepared for the disbelievers. Now, in verse number 23, after very aggressively challenging all the disbelievers who doubted in the truth of the Quran and the verses of Allah, Allah has mentioned the actual state of affairs and the intense punishment of all those involved in making such allegations on Quran and Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah says that you will not be able to fabricate or make a verse like Quran. And this has been actually so, because the words of Allah and the predictions of Allah, Alimul Ghaib, who is all knowing, have always been correct. And then Allah has warned all those who doubt that then, because of this doubt and because of all these allegations and because of all these failures of belief and faith and opposition to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they should fear the hellfire. And then mentioning the hellfire, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that the hellfire whose fuel will be men and stone. Remember the hellfire. Prophet has warned every one of us is going to be 69 times higher in temperature as compared to the fire on the earth. And here Allah is mentioning that the fuel of the hellfire will be stones and men, وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ, with stones. The stones which were used for making idols, or the stones which were carved into idols, will be burned in hellfire. This shows what? It shows the dislike of polytheism and the severity of the punishment for all who were worshipped and who worshipped other than Allah. The next part, وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ, the fuel of the hellfire will be men. Allahumma la taj'alna minhum. Wallah, save us from all. Save us all from the hellfire. How will men be the fuel of the hellfire? Because you know what? Science today tells us that the human body has so many components which assist and which can act as a fuel for fire, and they will assist in burning. For example, the human body has sulfur, human body has phosphorus, and these elements are present in the bones, in the hair, in the nails, And these are highly, highly inflammable. These are the elements and the chemicals which are used for making all forms of these fireworks, you know. And moreover, the human body has fat. Fat is a major part of the human body. Our brain is 95% fat. And fat, we all know, is an ideal fuel. So what lesson do we learn? The hellfire, which is 69 times hotter than the fire of this world, when the inmates of hell, they will be added, they will be thrown in the hell. The temperature will not drop. The fire will further flare up and the people of hellfire will be thrown in hell. And the temperature of fire will not drop. When the inmates will gather in hell instead, it will flare up even more. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the merciful, has been so kind and has been so loving and so caring for all of us that he has very kindly and very lovingly taught us the words of the supplication. We need to ask from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to get or to be released or to be saved and protected from the hellfire. We must learn, we must remember, and we must very frequently ask for this. Allahumma ajirna minan nar. Allahumma ajirna minan nar. O Allah, save ourselves from the torments of hellfire. And you know what? What the sunnah of the Prophet was, that he used to recite this supplication 7 times after his Fajr Salah and 7 times after the Maghrib Salah. And then another words of the narration of the Prophet also inform us, the Prophet said that whoever seeks refuge from the hell thrice, then the hell itself intercedes for him. So whenever you want to make this supplication of Allahumma ajirna minan nar. In fact, there are people who say Allahumma ajirni, that is save me. No, we're going to make this supplication in form of plural. Save all of us. Why be selfish when we're going to make this dua? So save all of us. We're going to say Allahumma ajirna. And whenever you ask for this, you need to ask it thrice so that hell itself intercedes for us. And then make it a habit to recite this dua 7 times after Fajr and 7 times after Maghrib, because inshallah we will be rewarded to follow a sunnah as well. And inshallah the supplication will be accepted on our behalf also. Verse number 25. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here says, وَبَشِّرُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَأَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ أَنَّ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ كُلَّمَا رُزِقُوا مِنْهَا مِنْ ثَمَرَاتٍ رِزْقًا قَالُوا هَذَا الَّذِي رُزِقْنَا مِنْ قَبْلُ وَأُوتُوا بِهِ مُتَشَابِهًا وَلَهُمْ فِيهَا أَزْوَاجٌ مُطَهَّرَةٌ وَهُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. And give good tidings. Good tidings to whom? To those who believe and do righteous deeds, and they will have gardens. Remember, for acquiring Jannah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions 2 prerequisites, belief and righteous deeds. For release and from protection from the hellfire and to enter into paradise, we are not just going to need belief and faith. A combination of both belief and faith followed by righteous deeds. So if people are just doing righteous deeds and virtuous deeds and they are lacking the faith and belief, they will not be rewarded with Jannah as per the teachings and verses of Quran. And those who just have belief, but they are not doing these righteous deeds as taught by the teachings of Quran and Sunnah, then they do not have the right and they do not have the promise of Allah in the verses of Quran. So Allah is giving good tidings to those, number one, who believe. And then after belief and faith in the teachings and messages of Allah in Quran and Hadith, they do what? They do the righteous deeds. Then they will have gardens. Where? In the paradise. How will these gardens be? Beneath which rivers flow? Subhanallah. And whenever there, they are provided with provisions of fruits therefrom, they will say, this is what we were provided with before. Before where? In the world, in the life, in the world. And it is given to them in lightness. And they will have their in purified spouses. Allahumma ja'alna minkum. Allah, make us one of them. And they will abide therein eternally. Now, in this verse number 25, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning about the good tidings to the believers and those who perform righteous deeds. The good tidings of Jannah. Remember, wherever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the punishments of hell and hellfire, immediately he mentions about Jannah. The mention of hell and the mention of Jannah, they are always parallel and side by side in Quran, because fear and hope, they are both needed for a believer. So Allah here is talking about those who are, after talking about the people who had doubt and the disbelief, Allah mentioned about hellfire. And now here Allah is mentioning the rewards of all those who believe. Now in the verse, the people of Jannah have been promised as the gardens in paradise. And then Allah has mentioned or promised them fruits. And about talking about fruits, Allah says that the fruits of Jannah, they will be resembling the fruits of this world. Why would it be so? Because you know, Allah the Rahman and Allah the Rahim, he knows the human temperament because he is our creator. He knows our temperament. He knows that human beings tend to stay away from something which they are not familiar with, from the unknown. So the fruits of Jannah will be resembling the fruits of our world in their appearance, in their color, and in their shapes, so that the inmates of Jannah will feel no strangeness towards them. But you know what? Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has informed all of us that the fruits of Jannah will be similar in color to an appearance to the fruits of the world, but they will be many, many times juicier and bigger and much, much better in all forms than the fruits of this world. For example, you know, the days of Jannah, they will be as big as huge pots. And Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has told us that they will be as soft as butter and they will be as sweet as honey. And the berries of Jannah, they will be on trees on which there will be no thorns, so that it will be easy for all the inmates of Jannah to get them and to reach them. Now, verse number 26. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَسْتَحْيِي أَنْ يَضْرَبَ مَثَلًا مَا بَعُوزَةً فَمَا فَوْقَهَا فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فَيَعْلَمُونَ أَنَّهُ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ وَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا فَيَقُولُونَ مَاذَا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ بِهَذَا مَثَلًا يُضِلُّ بِهِ كَثِيرًا وَيَهْدِي بِهِ كَثِيرًا وَمَا يُضِلُّ بِهِ إِلَّا الْفَاسِقِينَ. Indeed, Allah is not timid or shy to present an example, that of a mosquito, or what is smaller than that. And those who have believed know that it is what? That these examples of Allah's creation, like mosquito or what is even smaller than that, that it is the truth from the Lord. But as for those who disbelieve, they say, what did Allah intend by this as an example? He misleads many thereby, and he guides many thereby, and he misleads not except the defiantly disobedient. The disobedience has been called as what? Al-Fasiqeen. So in this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about or mentioning the name of one of his creations, the mosquito, ba'uzatan fama fawqaha, or something which is above it. Ba'uzatan means a mosquito, and what is something which is above it, fama fawqaha, it is explained by the narrators of Quran that it refers to a very small or a tiny virus or a tiny microorganism, which is not even visible by the naked eye, which just resides or it stays as a parasite above the head of the mosquito. So that is exactly what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, that one of the tiniest creation which is visible by the naked eye, that is a mosquito, or even a tiny creation which is not even visible by the tiny with the naked eye, or is just visible by a microscope, Allah does not even feel timid or shy in explaining or talking or mentioning about that. The verse is a scientific verse. And people of those periods, they could not relate or understand what fama fawqaha means. Today, when science explains us that there are microorganisms which live as a parasite or as a symbiotic form with the mosquitoes, we relate how scientific Quran is and how slowly and steadily with the advancement of science and scientific knowledge and with the different fields of knowledge, the Quran and the messages and verses of Quran go unraveling. Rabbi Zidni Ilma. Now, the verse explains what? You know what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has talked about his creation, and not only has talked about his creation, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has named many of his surahs and chapters of Quran with the names of his creation. Small creations, for example, in Surah Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Surah Quran, which is the peak of Quran, which is Sanamul Quran, which is the hump of Quran. The name is derived from what? The cow. Surah Naml gets its name. And Allah has also mentioned about the ant, the Naml. Surah Al-Ankabut, Allah names the Surah and also mentioned the Surah, the spider, Al-Ankabut. Then Surah Nahl. Allah names the surah, and then Allah talks about the honeybee. Inshallah, in our discussion of all these chapters of Quran, we shall be talking about these miracle creations of Allah. But today, I think I would need to explain a few things about the mosquito itself. You know what the disbelievers used to criticize? When Allah used to talk about the ant, or talk about the honeybee, or talk about the mosquito, the disbelievers, the purpose of whose relation with Quran was just to criticize. These were the people who were just stubborn and obstinate, and the purpose of their life was just to oppose. The disbelievers used to criticize, and now, Zubillah, they used to make fun of them. And they used to say that, why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talk about such small creation? So that is why Allah has explained this here in this verse. Now, the verse shows what? The first message we get from here is that for the Creator, all his creations are important and special. May it be big, may it be small, may it be strong, may it be weak. All the creations are important for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his sight and in the sight of the creation. So never, never, ever do we need to be proud or arrogant. Allah likes all his creations. And then I've already explained what fama fawqaha means. If he mentions a small germ, if he mentions a small virus or microorganism, then never ever do we need to be arrogant in front of his creations or his beings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all stay in a state of humbleness and help us take out any forms of arrogance if there is in our hearts. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions all his creations and speaks about all of his creations. A mosquito is what? A mosquito is a remarkable miniature creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I will say that A mosquito is a remarkable piece of miniature art of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is, no doubt, a mini helicopter. Now, talking about some of the things Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created, remarkably created in the mosquito, the wings of the mosquito. The wings of the mosquito, they are thin. They are extremely thin. They are even thinner and more transparent than the finest of tissue papers. But yet they are extremely powerful. These extremely thin wings, they vibrate with such an immense frequency and velocity and the speed that this vibration, this is what creates the buzzing sound of the mosquito when it hovers around our ears and our cells. And the speed of the wings is why? Because these thin wings, they have been provided with an intricate network of blood vessels supplying the wings, the muscles, the joints of the wings, all forms of energy. Subhanallah. In these paper thin wings, how did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala create a network of those fine tubes of blood vessels? And how does blood run in all those blood vessels, giving energy and power to all the muscles? And then Allah, in those fine wings, created muscles and joints and blood vessels and blood. Subhanallah. And then, you know, the legs, they are thinner even than the finest threads of silk, but they act as one of the most powerful landing pads of a helicopter. The helicopter lands on the helipad, and similarly does the mosquito land wherever it has to land. These are the powerful, finest, finer than even the thread of a silk. And being so powerful, they have joints, they have bones, they have muscles. Subhanallah, Allahu Akbar. Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu Akbar. And then in flight, you know, the helicopter just moves forward, but this miniature helicopter, the mosquito, it moves forwards, it moves backwards, it moves upwards, it moves downwards, it moves in all forms. And then the eyes of the mosquito, we, the superior beings, we who tend to be so arrogant, we have two eyes. And the mosquito, some species of mosquitoes have been, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed them with 100 pairs of eyes and some with 50 pairs of eyes and things like that. And then the diet of the mosquito. What is the diet of the mosquito? It's the blood. It sucks blood, and that is what it feeds on. But how does he get the blood? Allah, the Razik, the Razak, has so graciously provided the mosquito with all the resources to be able to suck the blood it needs for its survival. It lands on the human skin. How does it land? Why does it land there? How does it penetrate and puncture the skin, and how does it suck? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the mosquito everything. You know what? To cut the human skin, this tiny little creature, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided with 4 to 8 very strong canine teeth. We have 2 pairs of canine teeth, 2 canines on the upper jaw and 2 canines on the lower jaw. But the mosquito has been given with 2, depending upon the different species, has been given 4 to 8 pairs of canine teeth, which are like saws. They are like very sharp saws, and they have very, very sharp cutting edges. In addition to these canine teeth acting as source, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has provided the mosquito with very powerful jaws, which are going to move these sores as cutters. So this makes the tiny creature, it makes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, makes it very easy to puncture the human skin. Now, another thing, when the skin, we know that when the skin, human skin is cut or it is abraded, then the blood flows from it. But very soon, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the blood an intrinsic inbuilt mechanism that the blood clots, and then obviously it puts a plug at the point where there was a cut and the blood stops flowing. That is a protective mechanism for the human body. Now, what happens here? Imagine if the mosquito made a tiny puncture and the human blood clotted and closed off the puncture, what would have happened? Obviously, the mosquito would have been deprived. But Allah is the creator. Allah is the creator of the man and the human body. And Allah is the creator and the sustainer, both of the human being and the mosquito. So what has Allah done? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the mosquito, has created in the mouth or the buccal cavity of the mosquito, tiny glands. These tiny glands produce what? These tiny glands produce secretions, or a fluid which has anti-clotting properties. Now, the ducts of these glands, they pass on from the buccal cavity to the canine teeth, which are going to act as the saws and the cutters. And you know what happens when the teeth or the canine teeth or the saws are cutting or puncturing the human skin? At the same time, the ducts of the glands are pouring the anti-clotting fluid in the blood, which stops the blood from clotting, and the blood does not clot as long as the teeth remain there and the secretions are poured in, and the mosquito sucks as much blood as it wants for its to fill up its stomach. And then in addition, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in addition to the ducts of these glands, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has also made and adjusted ducts of the suckers. The tiny suckers which are going to operate to suck blood. How intricate and how delicate and how small this mosquito, and then how tiny the buccal cavity, and there you have a gland, and there you have suckers, and there you have ducts of both attached to the canines, one sucking out, one pouring in. What do we need to say? Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. This is Allah. This is Allah, the Rabbul Alameen, the Razik for all. And then you know another remarkable feature. How does the mosquito get exactly where the bloodstream is? Because you know, when we are getting an intravenous injection or when we are getting a blood test, you know, there are many times the technician misses our vessels. The technician just cannot get in the needle in our vein. Now, how does the mosquito puncture the skin and directly get into the blood vessel? It could have made a puncture in the skin beneath which there is no blood vessel and missed the hit. But no, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided the mosquito with highly sensitive, extremely sensitive thermal sensors, temperature sensors on the undersurface of the body of the mosquito. Because when it hovers over the surface of our body or our skin, these sensors will sense the part of the skin under which there is a blood vessel. Because science today tells us that the temperature of the skin beneath which there is no blood vessel is comparatively micro degrees of centigrade lower than the temperature of the skin, which is over a blood vessel. So the extremely sensitive thermal sensors of the mosquito's bodies under surface, they detect the slightly higher temperature of the skin flowing under which the blood is flowing in the blood vessels. So that is exactly where the mosquito lands. And when it punctures the skin, it is successful in puncturing the skin beneath which there is a blood vessel, and that is punctured. So this is Allah. He is just one. He is perfect. He is the best physicist. He is the best biologist. He is knowing of all. And there is, he is Subhan. He is perfect. So now remember that he is Razik. He has arranged and provided for the risk of this tiny creature. He will surely arrange for and provide for our and our offspring's sustenance also. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with tawakkul, bless us with reliance, and let all of us refrain from unlawful earnings. Allahumma arzuqni an halalika an haramik wa agnini bi fadlika amman sivak. And in the end of the verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comments that the example of such a creature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increases the iman of all the believers. Allahumma ja'alna minhum, Allah make us one of them, but leads to the disbelief of whom? Illa al-fasiqeen. Fasiqeen, the root word of fasiqeen is what? Fasin of. Fisk means disobedience. Disobedience. And fasiqeen are who? This is the fourth group of people. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about here is fasiqeen, the disobedience. Now in the verse number 27 is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala going to explain the traits and the behaviors and the mannerisms of those who are what? Al-Fasiqeen. They are mentioned in verse number 26. And now in verse 27, Allah says, Fasiqeen are who? Al-Lazina, those who yanquzuna ahdallahi min ba'di mithaqihi wa yaqta'una ma amara Allahu bihi an yusala wa yufsiduna fil ardh. The fasiqeen are the disbelievers are whom? Who break the covenant of Allah when? After contracting it. And the second thing is, they sever which Allah has ordered to be joined. And the third, the trait of the fasiqeen is, they cause corruption on earth. And the result of fisk is what? Or the punishment of fasiqeen is what? It is those who are the losers. Ulaika humul khasirun. They are the people who are the losers. Now in this verse, Allah has explained the traits and the punishment of the fasiqeen and the disobedience. The first is what? They break the covenant of Allah. What covenants do the bondsmen make with Allah? Number one, La ilaha illallah. This is the first covenant which a bondsman makes when he or she he embraces Islam, that I will obey and worship nobody other than Allah. Another covenant with Allah is Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. That is the second formula, the second kalima, which we have been taught and we recite when we are in the tashahhud of our salah. Then the two covenants of Surah Fatiha, which we recite in the Qiyam of Surah, Qiyam of our Salah, which we learned in Surah Al-Fatiha, Iyaka na'budu wa Iyaka nasta'in. Nobody other than you will we obey, nobody other than you we will worship, and we will just ask or seek help from you. So these are the covenants which a person makes with Allah. So it is the disobedience when they make promises and pacts and covenants with Allah, they break the covenants of Allah. This is the first behavior and attitude and the attribute of the fasiqeen. The second is what? They do what? They sever what Allah has ordered to join. Now, what has Allah ordered his bondsmen to join? Which the disobedient sever? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered the bondsmen to join the relations of kin, the blood relations, the relations because of the mother's womb. And how do you relate to that? How do we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered us to join what? The relations of kin? How many times in the verses of Quran has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to join or to keep the bonds of the relations of kin? Like verse number 83 of Surah Al-Baqarah, which we will be inshallah soon discussing, Allah says, mentioning the covenant with Bani Israel, Allah says, وَإِذْ أَخَذْنَا مِيثَاقَ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ لَا تَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا وَذِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينَ. When Allah accepted a pledge from the Bani Israel, Allah made a covenant with the Bani Israel that worship none except Allah, and be kind or do good or do ihsan to your parents, to the relation of kins, to the orphans and to the poor. وَقُولُوا لِلنَّاسِ حُسَنًا. These are the 10 commandments of Musa alayhi salam, which was taken as a covenant from the people of Bani Israel. And these are the basic 10 teachings of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the teachings of Quran as well. So in these first 10 commandments of Moses and 10 teachings of the Quran, the first is to avoid making partners with Allah, to be kind and to be merciful and do ihsan with the parents. And then the third right is of the relations of kin. Then in the first verse of Surah Nisa, Allah says, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي تَسَالُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامِ. Fear Allah. So if you want to be pious, if you want to be God-fearing, in whose name you demand your rights of the ties and the relations of kin. So the behavior and the mannerism of the pious people and the God-fearing people is to join the bonds of kin. Then in the verse 90 of Surah An-Nahl, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned the three and highlighted the three clear do's and don'ts of Quran, the three do's of Quran, Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْأَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى. The three highlighted do's of Quran. Allah enjoins upon you, number one, justice. Then doing goodness, that is being kind and doing ihsan. And third is itai wal qurba, spending generosity towards your relations of kin. And then in the verse 177 of Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah explaining the concept of virtues, ayat al-birr. Allah says, laysal birra an tawallu wujuhakum qibala al-mashriqi wal-maghrib walakinnal birra man amana billahi wal yawmil akhir wal malaikati wal kitabi wan nabiyyin wa atal mala ala hubbihi dhabil qurba wal yatama wal masakin. Allah says, the concept of true virtue is not that you turn your faces towards the east or west, but the true virtue is, number one, belief. The first virtuous condition is belief in Allah, in the day of judgment, in his angels, in his books, and in his prophets. And after belief, the first virtuous deed is what? أَعْطَ الْمَالَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ ذَوِي الْقُرْبَىٰ. To spend his wealth for the love of Allah, on whom? On the relations of kin. So if I summarize here, if we, all of us, we want to fulfill the covenant of Allah, you want to fulfill the covenant of Allah, you want to come up to the level of the God-fearing, pious people, you want to obey the dues of Allah, you want to be among the virtuous people and you want to do the virtuous deeds. And fourthly, you do not want to be among the disobedience. And what do we need to do? We need to connect and we need to join the bonds of kin. And we need to refrain from severing and from breaking and disconnecting the bonds of the kin. Loving and treating our relatives well is what is being ordered here. And you can gather all this, what Allah orders to join. Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala and who reports in Bukhari that Prophet said, قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى مَنْ وَصَلَكَ وَصَلْتُهُ وَمَنْ قَطَعَكَ قَطَعْتُهُ. That Allah said, I shall keep connection with one who keeps you united, and I will sever connection with one who severs you, O Raham. So this is what Allah's orders is, to join the relations of kin. And similar words have been reported in Abu Dawud with Abdul Rahman bin Auf, that Allah, the most exalted, says, I am Allah, I am Rahman, the merciful. I have created the bonds of kinship and given the name of Rahima. Thus, whoever joins it, I shall join him. And whoever breaks it, I shall break him. So anybody who is joining the relations of kin, Allah will join him with what? Allah will join him with his blessings, with his bounties, with his guidance. Allah will join him and connect him with Quran. And anybody who is going to break the relations of kin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will break him, will disconnect him from his blessings, from his bounties, from his guidance, with his love, with his connections of Quran. So this is the importance of joining the relationship of kin. And then Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has warned us all. Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala and who has reported in Bukhari and Muslim, qala Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, la yadkhulul jannata qati'un. Whoever violates, whoever severs the relationships of kin shall not go to heaven. La yadkhulul jannah. As-sadiq al-amin, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has warned all of us that the person who severs the relationship of kin, he will not be allowed to enter into Jannah. What can you assume? Will he be allowed to enter into Jannah? Hazrat Anas radiallahu ta'ala and who reports that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, in Bukhari and Muslim, it has been reported that whoever wants an increase in his sustenance and that the marks of his feet remain for a longer time in the world, that he lives long, should be kind and helpful to his relatives. So if all of us, we want to prolong our life and we want that our sustenance and risk has barakah, then what do we need to do? We need to be kind to our relatives and relations of kin and to join the relationships of kin. And you know what? How do we need to join these relationships of kin and how do we need to relate to them? Hazrat Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu ta'ala and who narrates in Bukhari, the Prophet said that the one to join the ties is not truly the one who reciprocates a kind act of relatives, but the one to join the ties is who joins the ties even when the others sever them. So this is exactly how we need to join the relationships of kin. That people who are disconnecting the connections, we connect with them. It is reported in Tirmidhi that Prophet ﷺ was asked that what is the way of saving our hereafter? That how can we save our hereafter? You know what Prophet ﷺ said? You maintain the ties with one who severed it with you. You give to the one who deprived you. And you forgive the one who wronged you. So this is how we do not reciprocate in the relationships of kin. And we just go on maintaining it with people who are trying to cut them off. And this is why and how we can save our hereafter. Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu reports that there was a person, he reports in Muslim that there was a person who came to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he asked a problem in his life. He said, O Messenger of Allah, I have relatives with whom I try to keep in touch, but they cut me off. I treat them well, but they abuse me in return. I am patient and forgiving towards them, but they insult me in return. Kindly instruct and guide me. What should I do and how do I need to relate with them? You know what Prophet ﷺ said? He said that if you are as you say, that the state of affairs you're telling me in your dealings and your mannerism, if they are exactly as you are claiming, then it is as if you are putting hot ashes in their mouth. And Allah will continue to support you as long as you go on doing and behaving this way. So this is what Hadith teaches us, how we need to maintain and relate to our relations of kin. And then Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was asked, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, tell us, how can we enter into Jannah? And Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, you know, four things he said, feed the poor and hungry. Number one, feed the poor and the hungry, join the bonds of the kin, promote the salam, and offer salah when people are asleep. You will enter paradise. You will enter paradise. Allahumma ja'alna minhum. And then Bukhari, it is reported that Prophet ﷺ said that whoever believes in Allah in the Day of Judgment should maintain good relations with the relationship of kin. And in Bukhari, it is also reported that Prophet ﷺ said, a Muslim is not allowed to abandon his Muslim brother for more than 3 days. And it is also reported in another tradition that Prophet ﷺ said that if a Muslim severs the ties of kin for a year, it is as if he has shed his blood. And Prophet ﷺ has taught us that if two Muslims, they have cut off or severed their relation of kin, and when they meet each other, then the person who proceeds with salam before the other is closer to the rahmah and barakah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Prophet ﷺ has promised that when there are two people who have cut off their relation and who are like, they are away from each other and they do not meet with each other, they do not connect with each other, then the person who says salam first, he has been promised as a palace in the center, in the heart of the Jannah. So these are the promises to all the people who maintain their bonds and relationships of kin. Now, what are the relations of kin? The relations of kin are the blood relations, the mother, the father, the grandparents, the children, the grandchildren, the brothers, the sisters, the maternal and the paternal aunts and uncles, and the nieces and the nephews by the brothers and the sisters. These are the relations of kin. Now, what are we supposed to do with them? As Allah says in Quran, the do of Quran, to save ourselves from fisk and disobedience, what do we need to do? Ita'i bil qurba. That is an order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To give them. So what do we need to give them? The first thing is we need to give them our money. Spend on them. Spend on them. If they are deserving of zakat, that is, if they do not have nisab and they are needy of zakat, the first right of our zakat and zakat money is of our relations of kin. وَآتَ الْمَالَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ. To whom? To spend money, to spend charity in the love of Allah, the first right is of whom? In the Ayatul Bir, آتَ الْمَالَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ زَوِ الْقُرْبَىٰ the قَرَابَ الدَّارِ. The people, the relations of kin. Then in Allah, in Surah Al-Baqarah says, يَسْأَلُونَكَ مَاذَا يُنْفِقُونَ. They ask, what do we need to spend? When we spend charity in the path of Allah, whom do we give? يَسْأَلُونَكَ مَاذَا يُنْفِقُونَ قُلْ مَا أَنْفَقْتُمْ مِنْ خَيْرٍ فَلِلْوَالِدَيْنِ وَالْأَقْرَبِينَ وَالْيَتَامَ وَالْمَسَاكِينَ. So the first charity which you spend is for the parents, and then is for whom? For the relationships of kin. So they are the most deserving of our zakat if they are in need and if they are deserving of zakat. And you know, I come to listen from so many scholars, keeps coming to me and asking me that a scholar says that we cannot give zakat to our relations of kin. Where is that written in Quran? On the contradictory, Allah says in so many verses that when you spend zakat, when you spend the supererogatory charities, the first right is that of what? Of the relations of kin. Now let me make you understand. Remember that for the men folk, the Muslim men, there are people around them, there are relations around the Muslim men to spend for them and to fulfill their requirements, monetary requirements, and to cater for them economically. Who are the economic dependents of the Muslim men? Are their children, their spouse, their wife, their old dependent parents, and the widowed sisters or the divorced sister who has no source of livelihood. So these are the dependents of the Muslim men. He can under no condition give them out of his zakat because they are dependents, and it is a duty of the Muslim man to spend on them, and he is answerable for not spending on them. So they have a right on his money. So for these dependents, he cannot give them out of his zakat. But for a Muslim man, all relations other than these dependents, he can give them zakat. For example, a Muslim brother, a Muslim aunt, a niece, a nephew, any of the other relations of kin who are not one of the dependents, a Muslim man can give out of his zakat if they can be given zakat. So what about the Muslim women? Islam and Quran does not put any duty on any Muslim woman to economically cater for any relationship. May it be her mother, her father, her brother, her daughter. In any relationship, the Muslim woman is not duty bound to economically fulfill their requirements. So a Muslim woman, if she is giving zakat and her brother or her father is deserving of zakat, she can give them zakat. So a Muslim woman can give zakat to her deserving father, to her brother, to her son, to her mother, to her sister, because she is not economically, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not made it her duty. And how do we gather this from? Now, in the words of a narration in Bukhari, Hazrat Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha, she heard a sermon of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam where he was instructing the Muslim women to spend charity in the path of Allah to save themselves from the hellfire. She came back home and she told that she had some zakat to be paid, and she discussed it with her husband, and he said that he had orphan children and he himself was economically in a crisis, and he asked her to give her charity and zakat to his orphan children. But she said that she will not do that until she consulted the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So she went to see Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she asked one of the companions to ask about her questions from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the companions presented her question to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam immediately asked that who is the lady who is asking this question. And the companion said that it is Hazrat Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and Prophet confirmed which Zainab. And he said, the companion told that it is Hazrat Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was the Zawja and who was the wife of Hazrat Abdullah bin Masud radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And since Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knew the economic state of affairs of Hazrat Abdullah bin Masud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, tell Zainab that if she spends on the orphan children of Hazrat Abdullah bin Masud, then she will be rewarded with double or double reward. Why? One reward for the spending of the charity in the path of Allah, and the second reward for attending and for helping her relations of kin. So there you are. A Muslim person can definitely and should realize also that the first right on our zakat and our charity is of whom? Of our deserving relations of kin. And now, if the relatives are not deserving of zakat, but they still are in need of help and economic support, then we can give them sadaqat, that our supererogatory charity, which we make beyond zakat. And even if we cannot give them, and we do not have to, or they do not need our sadaqat or zakat, alhamdulillah, and they are economically independent, then even we need to spend on them. As Prophet ﷺ has instructed, tahabu wa tahadu, you give and take gifts with each other, exchange gifts to increase and to promote mutual love. And then what else do we need to give them? We need to give them time. We need to give them importance. Giving importance to the relatives and relationship of kins was a sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As you see, on the occasion of the conquest of Mecca, which was no doubt a very, very highly important success in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, 10 years hence, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam emigrates from Mecca, hiding all by himself and totally all by himself in a state of crisis. And 10 years hence, he's walking into Mecca as the conqueror of Mecca, conquest of Mecca. He is behind him on his camel. He has whom? Giving time, importance, his cousin, his maternal cousin, the son of Hazrat Abbas, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, is sitting behind him. So give them importance, give them time. And then make dua for the relations of kin. The best gift. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been seen making supplications and making dua so frequently. He used to ask for Allahumma faqqihhu fid din. He asked for this for Hazrat Abdullah bin Abbas so frequently. And then give them what? Give them sincere advice. Give them guidance. Give them love. Give them help. Give them support. Give them care. And give them affection, but do not give them what? Save them from your misbehavior, from your bad treatment, from your misconduct, from your bad manners, from your foul language, calling them with bad names, backbiting, and being dishonest to them, to cheat them and cover up any bad manners you find out they are up to. Save their honor and help them save their honor also. And then, relations of kin, how was Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam relating with them? I would definitely want to relate and recite an occasion in the life of our holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how kind he was. It was the night after the Battle of Badr. And what a big victory it was for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We all know, Yawmul Furqan, the big victory of the Battle of Badr. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's companions, they explained that it was the night of Badr, and we were observing that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam could not sleep. He was restless, turning and tossing in his bed. And the companions asked the reason to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that why he was so upset and he was so sleepless. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that it is the morning and it is the crying sounds of Hazrat Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, which are stopping me and which are upsetting me. Who was Hazrat Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu then? He was the paternal uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who had not till now embraced Islam. 13 years of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in inviting people in Makkah towards Islam and belief and faith, and his real maternal uncle refusing him. And not only that, after the Prophet ﷺ immigrated from Mecca, now 2 years after that, Hazrat Abbas radiallahu ta'ala, and who? He comes all the way from Mecca with the enemies of Prophet ﷺ in the army of the Quraysh in Mecca to fight in the battle against his nephew, against his orphan nephew. Not only not believing, not only just refusing, but there he is fighting with the companions and trying to shed the blood of the companions of Prophet ﷺ with his armies. Imagine the extent of opposition and enmity. But despite that, Prophet ﷺ is restless, listening to his moaning, his cry. Where are we? What are we doing? Claiming to be the followers of Prophet ﷺ and hoping that he will be interceding for us? Where are we? Do we know? Do we know who out of our relations of kin is moaning, who is in a state of crisis, who is crying through the night? And when any of us finds out that any relation of kin is upset in a state of crisis, how many of us stay sleepless in our nights? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us learn all that. And you know what companions did? They opened up the chains of Hazrat Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and then he stopped moaning. But then there Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was. Immediately he asked, what is the reason? Why has Hazrat Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, how has he stopped moaning? And the companions told that we had opened up his chains and cuffs and handcuffs to make him comfortable so that he stops moaning and that you can sleep comfortably. And then another message of the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he immediately said, listen, either you'd open up the chains of all the captives or you put back the chains of Abbas bin Abdul Muttalib, the paternal uncle of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also. Justice, equality. How are we behaving? Either we just leave and we just forget about some of the relations of kin, and those we remember and we care about, we just bend towards them, forgetting all about fair dealings. No, we have to remember, we have to care, but we have to be fair at the same time. And then on the next morning, when Prophet ﷺ gets up and he finds that his uncle is all injured and blood coming out and all his clothes torn, he asks the people in Medina to give him a shirt so that all his injuries can be covered up. And then he was tall and nobody's shirt could fit him up. And the leader of the hypocrites, his shirt fitted Hazrat Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And Prophet ﷺ was obliged, and he felt obliged to Abdullah bin Ubay. And then the day when Abdullah bin Ubay died, his son came over to the Prophet ﷺ and he asked, feeling upset for his father, he asked Prophet ﷺ to give his shirt for his coffin. And Prophet ﷺ took off his shirt, and Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu was there, and he said, Prophet ﷺ, will you give his shirt to the leader of the hypocrites? Prophet ﷺ said, O Umar, do not say that. Do not stop me from doing that. Don't you know that Abdullah bin Ubay, he obliged me by giving his shirt to my uncle when nobody's shirt would fit him? What is this? What is Sunnah teaching us here? Kindness, mercy, love to all, forgiving all, and acknowledging, accepting all those who were kind to us and who did ihsan to us. What are we doing? We don't even acknowledge who is being kind and merciful to us. But Prophet ﷺ is acknowledging not only acknowledging but repaying and returning the kindness and the mercy of even the people who have been kind to his relatives. These are the sunnahs of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We need to remember and adopt in our lives if we want the intercession of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on the day of judgment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us remember all these sunnah. And then Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is being kind to all the relations of kin. He was kind to all the relations, not only just to his maternal relations, even to his paternal relations. You see here, being kind to Hazrat Abbas, giving importance to the son of Hazrat Abdullah bin Abbas, to Hazrat Abdullah bin Abbas and another son of Hazrat Abbas. And then on the day of conquest, he comes where? To the house of Hazrat Umehani radiallahu ta'ala anha. And she comes up, she walks up to him and she says, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, my brother Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he's taken up his sword and he is hanging it on the top of, on the head of people whom I have promised security and aman. And what do I do? Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he had the time to listen to a cousin, a female paternal cousin, giving her importance, giving her time, giving her attention. And then he said, whomsoever Ummehani has given shelter, we have given shelter. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated to Medina. He stayed with his paternal relatives, with his maternal relatives. So he is seen giving importance to his maternal as well as his paternal relatives. But today we find women doing what? As mother, pumping up their children against her in-laws. Remember, I tell you from my heart, this mother is the worst enemy of the child. She is no doubt the worst enemy of the child who is trying to develop hatred in the heart of her child for her loving paternal grandparents, their paternal aunts and uncles. Where do you get sincerity? Can you buy it at any cost? The paternal grandparents, the grandmother, the grandfather, the only and the sole purpose of their life is maybe just to make supplications for your children. And they are the paternal uncles, the paternal aunts, the sincere, loving paternal aunts and uncles. They are the relations. How can we deprive our children of these sincere relations? How loving they are. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, may we not be those mothers and may we not be those wives who are going to poison their husbands and their children against their relatives. And then Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is also seen relating and connecting to all relations of in-laws, like Hazrat Isma, Hazrat Abdullah bin Umar, Hazrat Abdullah bin Abbas, the nephew of Hazrat Maymuna radiallahu ta'ala anha. So this is what it is. Connecting to all relations of kin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us relate to all these messages of Quran and to adopt all these messages of Quran. And then the third trait of the fasiqeen here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned, is they do what? They cause corruption. This is the same trait which Allah talked about in the traits of munafiqeen and the hypocrites. And I have talked about that in detail in those verses. So the three traits of the disobedience is that they break the covenants of Allah and they survey the relationships of kin and they cause corruption and fitna and fasad on the earth. And the result and the punishment of these is what? Ulaika humul khasirun. They are the losers. Allahumma la taj'alna minhum. Now, if I make a summary here from the previous two chapters, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala handed us the Quran and said, Zalikal Kitabu la Raiba Fee, Hudal Lil Muttaqeen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after that, in the next few chapters, explained about the four categories of people who are going to develop in the students of Quran, and Allah has also mentioned how are they going to end up in. So the first group of people was the Muttaqeen. The God-fearing people are the pious people, are the believers. They were what? Ulaika humul muflihun. They were the people who are going to be successful here and hereafter. The second people were innal lazina kafaru, that is the kafirs, the disbelievers. Their result Allah mentioned, walahum azabun azim, for them there was what? A very painful punishment. A grievous punishment. And the third group was the hypocrites, the munafiqeen, the hypocrites. And Allah mentioned their traits and their two types. And then Allah said, walahum azabun aleem, for them is a punishment, a painful punishment, which I explained and elaborated by the verse number 140 and 145 of Surah Nisa. And now is the fourth group. We have talked today about their traits is the fasiqeen or the disbelievers, and their result will be ulaika humul khasirun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with iman, bless us with taqwa and fear of Allah, and help us be steadfast in belief and faith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our and the faith of our children and our family members also. And then in verse number 28, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then makes a question. Allah says, but kayfa takfuruna billahi wa kuntum amwatan fa ahyaakum summa yumeetukum summa yuhyikum summa ilayhi turja'un. That how can you disbelieve in Allah? So after mentioning the traits and the result of the disbelievers and the disobedience, Allah is addressing all the students of Quran in an interrogative manner. And Allah is asking that, how can you disobey Allah when you were lifeless and He brought you to life, and then He will cause you to die, and then He will bring you back to life, and then to Him you will be returned. So all the stages, Allah is mentioning what? That how can you disobey Allah when all the stages and all the happenings of your life are in the control of Allah and His decisions? When, where, how you will be, a person will be born or he will die. This is all totally dependent on the decision of the Creator. So when everything is in your lives is in the control and in the dictations of Allah, then what do you need? What do we all need? We need to surrender. We need to surrender our will, our desires to His orders, to His dictations also, and spend our life in total submission, in total obedience of our controller and our Creator. Verse number 29, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا ثُمَّ اسْتَوَى إِلَى السَّمَاءِ فَسَوَّاكُنَّ سَبْعَ سَمَاوَاتٍ وَهُوَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ. And it is He who created for you all of that which is on the earth. And then He directed Himself to the heaven, His being above all creation, and made them seven heavens. And He is knowing of all things. Rabbana, la tuzigh qulubana ba'da iz hadaytana wa hab lana min ladunka rahma innaka antal wahhab. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين آمين ثم آمين. الحمد لله ثم الحمد لله. We have complete We have completed our third chapter of Surat al-Baqarah today. Inshallah, we will continue with the fourth chapter next week. And I will request all of you to share our video on the Facebook so that it can be passed on to as many as you want to. And we will also, I will also request you to keep on inviting others in the WhatsApp group, sending them the link so that more people can join in. And inshallah, next week, the very interesting event and the story of the creation of Hazrat Adam, and then the tussle of the shaitan and the children of Adam, and what do we learn from the whole and the beautiful story in its narration. Stay connected and invite others. Fi amanillah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.